Good evening, everyone. Welcome to our evening service. And though it's not much of a service in the sense that we don't have any singing, in another 2 weeks, we'll finally be back at church, and how we are looking forward to that. But as we turn our attention to God's word this evening, I trust that you have come with a prepared heart and that you have come to hear what God has to say. We're going to read from 1 Corinthians chapter 12, and we're going to read from verses 8 through to 11, and we're just going to pick up on one verse this evening. 1 Corinthians 12, reading from verse 8. To one there is given through the Spirit the message of wisdom, to another the message of knowledge by means of the same Spirit, to another faith by the same Spirit, to another gifts of healings by that one Spirit, to another miraculous powers by that one Spirit, to another prophecy, to another distinguishing between spirits, to another speaking in different kinds of tongues, and still to another the interpretation of tongues. All these are the work of one and the same Spirit, and He gives them to each one as He determines. Let's pray. Our Father, as we wrestle through this somewhat difficult and controversial gift, we pray that you would help us to come to an understanding of what your word teaches us regarding this. We recognize that sometimes when we come to the difficult passages, there may be a diversity of understanding of these passages. And so we pray that you would help us to be gracious to those who perhaps see it from a different point of view. And we ask that you would enable us to be able to wrestle with this in ourselves and to be able to come to a conclusion that is most consistent with your word. I pray, Lord, for all who are watching, that as we work through this, that you would enable us to keep focused on the Lord Jesus Christ. Help us not to get too distracted. And we pray, Lord Jesus, that you would show the greatness of who you are and how you gift people in different ways and how those gifts function in the building up of your church. We commit ourselves into your hands for Jesus' sake. Amen. When I was a student pastor a long time ago now, some 25 years ago, in fact, even longer than that, I was in a church that was at that particular point in time still exploring some of the ways in which God's gifts work. And we were in a morning church service, I'll never forget it, and during our time of singing, where we were singing songs, there was just an open time we had after that. It was a much smaller church than this one, where we had opportunity for those who wanted to share something, perhaps a prayer request or a testimony or something else, just to be able to get that opportunity to do so. And there was a particular woman who stood up, and she stood up and made a statement something like this: I believe there's someone here this morning who is suffering, and I can't remember whether it was from a bad back or an abusive childhood. It was one of the two. And God is wanting to heal that person, and so would that person just make known who they are so that I can come and pray for that? And I remember as I was sitting here thinking, well, if this is the gift of prophecy, how does that work? If God has given this person insight that there's someone in the church suffering from back, and apparently according to the medical system, 80% of people suffer from that, or child abuse, and that's also high, then how is it that God hasn't revealed the name of that person to this particular person? It could apply to a range of different people in the church. And so began the journey of wrestling through how the spiritual gifts function. And I suspect for some of us, it's the same kind of things that we have to grapple with. Now, I want to slow down as we go through the gifts now and just take on this one gift tonight, and that is the gift of prophecy, and to try and look at it in some detail as we grapple with this and try to understand how it functions. It's one of those gifts that I think is very difficult to be dogmatic about. I think there are some things you can say with absolute certainty, and there are some things you can say with less certainty. And so what I want to do is just to try and pick apart what this gift is, how it functions, and how it's thought to be function, not just presenting one view, but presenting at least, I think, two viable views, and then drawing some conclusions from that. So we're going to just narrow down on what it means when it talks about the gift of prophecy in verse 10b, to another prophecy. The word that is used in the original language literally means interpreting the divine will or purpose from God. And when you look at how it is used again in Corinthians, and the particular form of this word is only used in Corinthians. It is used in different forms elsewhere in the New Testament. But when we take some time to examine the way that it's used, it doesn't give us a huge amount of help as to know what it means. Now, there are basically three possibilities of what this means. The first possibility is that this gift no longer is functioning. So that there are some who argue, and we're going to get there in 1 Corinthians 13, and I don't want to get ahead of myself, that speak about when knowledge comes to fulfillment, when knowledge comes to an end. And what they understand by that is they understand that when God's word is completed, that there's no longer a place for some of the sign gifts. So the gifts of healing, the gifts of tongues, the gifts of miraculous powers, and the gift of prophecy has ceased and come to an end. Now, while it's possible that that word could mean that, I don't think that word does mean that. I don't think that it is saying that with the completion of Scripture, somehow certain gifts have come to an end. I think that all the gifts continue to be exercised in the here and the now. Now, there are some who would see that differently. The second way, and I want to take a bit of time to deal with this because it's quite a popular way of understanding how this gift works. The second way in which it is understood is in the sense that someone is given prophetic insight from God, and then they stand up, whether it be in a church or in perhaps some other setting, but mainly in a church setting, they stand up and they speak a word of prophecy in that particular church. And so what they say is that they argue that the prophet is God speaking his revelation through them, through their gifts, but that the prophecy gift that they are exercising operates at a slightly lower level than the Old Testament and New Testament prophets who, when they speak, or apostles, speak direct revelation from God. They argue that the New Testament apostles were the equivalent of the Old Testament prophets who spoke Scripture into being. And as God, by the power of the Holy Spirit, came upon the Old Testament prophets and the New Testament apostles, God so guided them and so enabled them to write that they wrote exactly what God wanted them to write. Now, that didn't mean that God dictated to these prophets or apostles. Sometimes when you go to the Old Testament, there is some direct speaking of God that is recorded in Scripture. So it's not that God didn't from an occasion speak directly in that sense, and his direct words are recorded in Scripture. But in the main, God so moved upon these prophets and the apostles so that he guided not only their thoughts, but guided what they actually wrote. So that when they wrote, they were writing in conjunction with the Holy Spirit, and we have Scripture as we have it now. Now, what these people argue is that the prophets today are not on the same level as those prophets. They function at a slightly lesser level than those prophets. And they are referred to in 1 Corinthians 14, verse 29, where when the church comes together, let me read that for you just so that you say in 1 Corinthians 14:29, we are told two or three prophets should speak and the other should weigh carefully what is said. So they say that's what happens, that these prophets stand up and they speak. And as they speak a word from God, then if two or three have spoken, then all of that gets weighed. Now, these prophets then, or their prophecies, may be of mixed quality. In other words, the reason those prophecies are weighed is because some of them may be accurate and some of them may not be accurate. And so they argue that those prophecies are evaluated so that the bad can be sifted out and the good is retained. In other words, the authority, though different to that of the apostles who didn't have their words or the evaluated as such, these do have their words evaluated. The argument is based on the Agabus prophecy, which is wrong on details. And we get that in Acts chapter 28, where a prophecy is made and is fulfilled, but the details of that prophecy are not exactly fulfilled in the way in which it was originally given. And so it is argued that in the same way that these people stand up and speak, the details may not in fact be exactly accurate and sometimes needs to be sifted out. And so they are functioning at a lower level. They would also argue that there is a school of Old Testament prophets that Elijah is told about by God. I've reserved another 300 when Elijah says, I'm the only one that is alone. And then there's a school of prophets mentioned later in Samuel where it's spoken about some other prophets that obviously function at a different level. And so this is the equivalent of that. Now, that would be probably, I'd say today, the most popular way that this is kind of understood, that prophecy functions in this lower form, in this lower way. And if I can quote from John MacArthur on this particular thing and how it functions. This comes from his book, Charismatic Chaos, of a tape he received from James Ryle. Now, this is not R.C. Ryle, this is a different Ryle. James Ryle, pastor of the Boulder Valley Vineyard in central Colorado. Ryle described in detail some dreams of his which he took to be prophetic revelation from God. According to Ryle's dreams, God was getting ready to anoint Christian musicians with the same anointing that he was giving to the Beatles. He notes a word from the Lord, and I quote, I called those four lads from Liverpool to myself. There was a call from God on their life. They were gifted by my hand. It was I who anointed them, for I had a purpose, and the purpose was to usher in the charismatic renewal with the music revival around the world. So that is Ryle speaking on behalf of the Lord. When he says I, he's speaking as though the Lord was speaking. This is the revelation. This is the prophetic revelation that God gave him. What happened? According to Ryle, God told him, the four lads from Liverpool went AWOL and did not serve in my army. They served their own purpose and gave the gift to the other side. Ryle says that God told him in 1970, he lifted the anointing and has held it in his hand since then, but he is about to release it again into the church. Now, that kind of prophecy is how it would be understood in many circles. Now, what you would do with that prophecy is you would weigh it and you would remove what is wrong and you would retain what is good. The difficulty with such a view, I think, is numerous. And I want to go through some of the difficulties as why I think there is a better way of understanding prophecy than rather this way. The first is that the function of the prophet is misunderstood in reference to Agabus. The Bible uses agency to fulfill prophecy. In other words, I am said to do what I cause other people to do. What this means is that the agency through which the prophecy may be fulfilled is not necessarily directly related to what I do, but is fulfilled through other agents, though I may stand behind what is happening in that prophecy. A prophet is considered to be fulfilled even if I am not the one who specifically carries out that prophecy. Let me give you some examples of how that works. Acts 2:22. Men of Israel, listen to this. Jesus of Nazareth was a man accredited by God to you by miracles, wonders, and signs, which God did among you through him, as you yourselves know. This man was handed over to you by God's set purpose and foreknowledge, and you, with the help of wicked men, put him to death by nailing him on a cross. Now hear carefully what Paul is saying. Peter is saying that it is the Jews who are responsible for the death of Jesus. However, it is not the Jews who carry out the sentence of Jesus, but it is the Romans. It is the agency of the Romans who carry out his death. Then fast forward to Acts 13:27. The people of Jerusalem and their rulers did not recognize Jesus. Yet in condemning him, they fulfilled the words of the prophets that are read every Sabbath. Though they found no proper ground for death sentence, they asked Pilate to have him executed. Now it's Paul speaking, saying that in the same way that Peter spoke about it, even though it was not the Jews who directly put Jesus to death, they are responsible for him in spite of the Romans. Now we fast forward to Acts 28. 3 days later, he called together the leaders of the Jews. When they had assembled, Paul said to them, "My brothers, although I have done nothing against our people or against the customs of our ancestors, I was arrested in Jerusalem and handed over to the Romans." Now Paul is referring to this prophecy of Agabus there. And he's saying that even though the prophecy is not fulfilled in exactly the same details that was given to Agabus, nevertheless, the prophecy was fulfilled. And ultimately, it is the Jews who are responsible for him, even though the Romans ultimately bound him and took him and imprisoned him. The second problem has to do with deciding what's accurate and what's not. Now, what's really important here to understand is that when we go through all of the scriptures and we go through Old and New Testament, prophecy never functions like that. There's no instance in the Old Testament, for example, where a prophet came with a prophecy and then the people sat down and said, "Right, well, let's evaluate this prophecy and let's see what's true and let's see what's not true, and then we'll just remove what's not true from that particular prophecy." The test of a prophet was whether or not it was true and accurate. So, for example, Deuteronomy 18:18-20. "I will raise up for them a prophet like you from among their brothers. I will put my words in his mouth, and he will tell them everything I command. If anyone does not listen to my words that prophet speaks in my name, I myself will call him to account. But a prophet who presumes to speak in my name anything I've not commanded him to say, or a prophet who speaks in the name of other gods, must be put to death." And so it seems to me to be fairly clear that either a prophet spoke true or he spoke false. It was not a matter of evaluating whether or not some of his prophecy was accurate and some of it was not. It was either true or it wasn't. And if a prophet spoke falsely, a prophet was put to death. Or if a prophecy was false, that prophet should have been put to death. And you remember in one of the stories of one of the kings where he gathers a whole lot of prophets together who tell him to he's going to be successful, go and invade. And then he gets a true prophet who says to him, don't do it. And he goes with the other ones who have given a false prophecy, and it all ends in disaster. Jeremiah 14 verse 14 says, then the Lord said to me, the prophets are prophesying lies in my name. I have not sent them or appointed them or spoken to them. They are prophesying to you false visions, divinations, and idolatries and delusions of their own mind. The third problem has to do with authority. Now I want you to think about this. If someone is claiming to receive a message from God, a prophecy from God, and if God never lies, if God always tells the truth, Jesus, after all, proclaims and says, I am the way, the truth, and the life, then surely as God brings a prophecy to bear upon a person, that prophecy will be true. For it to be anything other than true would bring into question the very nature and character of God. And this problem is best perhaps demonstrated or seen in effect by what happens in the Catholic Church when the Pope sits in the chair and speaks ex cathedra. Now, apparently, the chair that he sits in is the chair of Peter. And the Catholic Church will claim that there is a direct line of descendants from Peter right down through every pope, so that when the popes stand up and make any proclamation, and when they sit in this chair, the chair of Peter, and they speak ex cathedra, they are speaking authoritatively from God, and whatever they say is then considered to be on par with God because it comes from God. And so you have certain traditions in the Catholic Church that are considered the equivalent of Scripture when those traditions or those things have been spoken by popes through history when they've sat in the chair of Peter. However, what we discover from Scripture is that it is only the apostles and only the prophets who are given that kind of authority. And God has spoken finally in His Scriptures. There is no new revelation in that sense. Now all we have is illumination of the revelation. In the past, God's, Hebrews 1:1, in the past, God spoke in many ways. In these last days, He has spoken finally, through His Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. So while there are some who believe there is a sense in which prophecy happens at a lower level, it doesn't seem to me to square up with the witness that we have of Scripture. Either prophecy is true or it's not. Either the prophet comes from God or they don't. And so to try and somehow come to some medium ground doesn't seem to me to be consistent with Scripture. So then, if that is not how prophecy works, if it is not working as a result of being mixed in truth and error, how then does prophecy function? Well, I think it functions in this way. It is functioning primarily in the sense of preaching the Word of God, and also in pastoral situations where God brings a word or the application of the word in a particular setting that may not only be limited to pastors, but may be limited to any setting where any believer in some sense is being given particular insight into the application of the already written word of God into that set of circumstances. Now, what is not clear from this particular passage is whether or not this gift of prophecy is something permanently that resides with a person, or whether it functions in the same way as the gifts of healings, that God may bring it upon a particular person at a particular point in time, specific to a particular situation that they are engaged with, and then perhaps it doesn't occur again. Let me try and read a definition and then break it down for you. I think this definition puts it really well. Prophecy, as a gift of the Holy Spirit, combines pastoral insight into the needs of persons, communities, and situations with the ability to address these with God-given utterance or longer discourse, whether unprompted or prepared, with judgment, decision, and rational reflection, leading to the challenge or comfort, judgment or consolation, but ultimately the building up of the addressees. Now, let me try and explain all of that. I know there's a lot in there. So what this gift is functioning, it certainly functions in the terms of the preached word of God. When someone stands up and begins to proclaim God's word, there is often a prophetic element to that proclamation. There may be a prophetic element in the sense of the particular situation that is being faced within that congregation or more broadly within that society. And God's word through the preacher is spoken prophetically into that situation that has specific and particular application to that particular set of circumstances that has arisen. Now, there are times when that prophetic nature of the preaching will have a profound effect upon that congregation. Now, let me try and illustrate this. I remember sitting, listening to someone describe to me where they'd been in a particular gathering of a church where a visiting speaker had come to that church. And as he preached that evening, it was in a particular evening service, and there were a lot of young people present in that service. God's Spirit so fell upon him from the passage that he was preaching that as he applied God's word and spoke prophetically, many of those young people in that congregation became full-time paid missionaries or pastors. It was an unusually large amount of young people who went into full-time paid service as a result of that particular preaching of the Word of God. Now, that is in a sense in which that particular preacher at that particular given moment spoke prophetically into that situation, and the Word of God had particular relevance for a large amount of young people as they were called into full-time paid Christian work. There are times where such preaching is particularly prophetic in its relevance. But there is another sense, I think, in which this gift works. I think it works in the sense of pastoral situations. So there are times where, and I suspect some of you have experienced this, and I know certainly in the conversations I've had, some of you have said this to me, where you may be in a particular situation talking with someone. It may be in the act of sharing your faith. It may be in the act of helping them through a particular marriage problem. It may be helping them in facing a particular difficult circumstance in their working situation, or a particular difficulty with they're having in a family situation. It may be in a particular financial problem that you're trying to help someone through. There could be a range of scenarios that you and I could think about. But as you are giving advice, as you are speaking to this person, suddenly God gives you particular clarity. And he brings a particular scripture to mind. And that scripture has particular relevance for this situation. And as you speak, there is an overwhelming sense that God's Spirit is directing you to that scripture, is putting words into your mouth and enabling you to speak with particular authority into that situation that either might come in the form of a rebuke, it might come in the form of encouragement, it might come in the form of building them up, it might come in the form of particularly wise counsel that you're giving. Now, I know that some of you have experienced this because you've shared that with me. I know that in my own set of circumstances, there have been times where I've been with particular people and I sense that God is leading me to a particular scripture and giving me the ability to bring particular application of that scripture into their lives. And I think that that is how God uses this gift of prophecy within his church. Now, if I may use a personal example, this happened to me when I was dealing with someone not at this church. It's a long, long time ago. None of you know the people involved, so I'm not sharing any kind of confidential information. But when I was dealing with a particular person who had come to me because they were having some marital difficulties, and they had unfortunately been involved in an adulterous relationship. And as I was speaking to them, I sensed God prompting me to ask them whether or not they had had multiple affairs. And so I did. And they came out and said, yes, they had multiple affairs. And it was that sense that God's Spirit came upon me, enabling me to ask him that question that I felt was an unusual experience that I had. Now, it's that kind of thing that I was then able to deal with that and help them to move and to address that situation in their lives. And so there may be times when you are in a similar situation. You may be witnessing to someone and suddenly God just brings an illustration to mind or brings some relevance to mind that enables you to speak with particular power into that person's life. I think that's the way in which prophecy functions. Now, I don't want to be dogmatic about that. I don't want to, in any sense, say there are others who see it slightly differently and have different reasons for understanding it. But I think this is the most consistent way. It comes through the preaching of God's word, and it comes in pastoral situations, not just involving pastors, but involving more than just pastors, where God brings a particular word of relevance. Now, of course, we see this most exemplified, do we not, in the life of the Lord Jesus Christ. Just take a look at Jesus. Jesus functions consistently in this sense, whether it's his encounter with the woman at the well, where he says to her, do you have a husband? And he says to her, you in fact have multiple, don't you? You've been involved in multiple relationships. Whether it's a woman caught in adultery and Jesus shows particular compassion. Whether it's looking into the lives of the Pharisees and bringing out certain things that are hidden beneath the surface in his encounter with those Pharisees. Whether it's revealing the stumbling block to those who would follow Jesus. You remember the young man who wants to follow Jesus and Jesus says to him, one thing you lack is give away all your wealth. You're so close to the kingdom of God. And Jesus speaks prophetically into his life and saying, this is the one barrier that's withholding you from coming into the kingdom of God. It's that sense in which Jesus exemplifies how this gift works. And obviously for Jesus, the difference between him and us is that it is something permanently bestowed upon him and he exercises it consistently. For you and I, it might only happen once in a while or it might only happen once in our lives. It may never happen in our lives. But it is certainly, I think, the way in which this gift functions. So can I encourage you applicationally now, if I might just work out some application. Prophecy is not about telling someone's fortune. It does not consist in someone approaching you and saying to you, God's got a message from me to you. You should be asking that person, well, why hasn't God told me first? It doesn't function in that sense. It's not someone coming to you telling you about their future. It is someone who comes in your situation or you in someone else's situation where you are able to bring particular relevance of God's word, particular application into their particular situation. And it enables you to speak with great clarity, great authority, great relevance. And as a result, the person to whom you are engaging with is either rebuked in God's presence, is either built up in God's presence, is either encouraged through the word that you have brought to them, and is either helped in their particular situation to know how to proceed, to know how to deal with the circumstance that has risen in their life, enables them to be able to receive some kind of benefit from this word that is this prophetic word that has been spoken into them, into their lives. And I think that it may be that as we remain open to the Lord, as we plead with God, as we ask Him to help us in a range of situations, that God may from time to time visit this particular gift upon you in enabling you to speak into the lives of others in difficult situations. That, I think, is the most consistent way with understanding how, though I think it primarily works in the function of preaching, I think in a secondary way, it works in these pastoral situations that you and I, evangelism situations that you and I encounter from day to day. Amen. Our Father, we thank you for your word. We pray that you would just help us to recognize the difference between when you are leading us by the power of the Spirit into a particular prophetic way into someone's life, or whether it be through the preaching of your word. Help us to recognize the difference between when it's you who are leading us and you pointing us to your word and you bringing a word of relevance to our own minds, simply trying to create something. And I pray for those, Lord, who are faced in these kinds of situations in their day-to-day Christianity, where you may, through your Spirit, choose to come upon them and give them a particular insight into a particular situation, whether it be sharing their faith or whether it be helping someone through a problem. Help them to recognize them and help them to respond in obedience to you in exercising this gift of prophecy. And we pray this for Jesus' sake. Amen. I trust that you will have a great week that lies ahead.